my teacher, gave an extra credit question at the end of the exam. And the question was translated to Sanskrit. In heaven, the gods speak Sanskrit. Those who do not know that language are not admitted there. He was such a snob. He was wanting to get you to go on for the second semester. That was his trick.
So we're going to look. We're going to gaze upon the Keno Panishad. In the booklet here, we don't have the Sanskrit verses, we just have a translation. I think on page 8 it starts.
That's nice.
In here. But the way these shastras, these scriptures work, is you would traditionally learn it in Sanskrit, and often you couldn't quite understand what it was saying. And you just memorize it, and then you kind of use it like a mantra. And then after thousands of years, you start to go, oh, that's what they mean. But we read like a translation, we go, oh, that's how they need that, you know. Blow it off. So I'll this first one is asking about, the second verse is asking about eyes. So these are the eyes of my eyes, these meeting glasses. The mystery is no longer the eye of the eye.
Well, everybody's
okay. So, let me start just by saying, has anyone ever met a two-year-old? A two-year-old child.
Yeah.
Not a two-year-old adult.
Yeah,
they're around. And it's usually around the age of two. Like many of them, not all of them, go through this one period where they want to know why.
Oh, yes, right.
And it's a very profound thing. You know, it's like Socrates is coming right through them. And you ask them to do something like, you know, why don't you pick that up? And then they say, why? And I know with our son, and perhaps this was a mistake in retrospect, we would try to explain why. And you give a good explanation, and, you know, we want to pick it up so we keep the house clean and so there are no germs that grow on the floor. And then he goes, and he says, why? And then you have to go down to the next layer of explanation, which is usually we have to talk about bacteria and germ theory and disease and immune systems. And this is with a two-year-old. And then you explain that as best, you know, to the extent of your scientific knowledge. And he goes, why? And then you have to go into the psychology explanation. Because it makes us happy to be healthy. And then, why? And there's no end to the why. It is like, and you, eventually, a lot of parents, they just say, because I said so.
I know, they do.
And then there's blocked, and that's like the end of the spiritual.
That's truly terrible. Crippling in the mind of it.
Oh, yeah. So, to this day, we're still trying to answer.
Check it out in the internet.
Oh, that's the way it is. Google it.
You will check it out in the internet when you can read and write earlier.
Push a button.
Why?
Why?
Why? Why? And Patabi Joyce, I don't know whether he, you know, you never knew what he was doing on purpose, but he would always go, why? He say, "Oh, Guruji, I'm very tired today." And he would say, "Why?" And then he'd explain, "Well, it's because I ate too much for dinner, you know, and, you know, I'm jet lag." And he would go, "Why?" And he said, "Oh, because I couldn't eat earlier in the day, and, you know, it's like a 15,000-mile flight to get here." And I'd go, "Oh, why?" And he'd go, "Well, because of the earth." You know? And it was the same experience. You know? And he'd just be like laughing away, "Why?"
That's great. 90 years old, that's awesome.
Yeah, I was, "Why?" So this is the why Upanishad.
So the why Upanishad.
The why.
Wonderful.
And so the first verse, it sounds like this. Look at it. Kineshitam patati preshitam manaha kina prana pratama praiti yuktaha kineshita vachami mam vadanti chakshu shrotram Udevo Yunakti. So I'll read you two translations, because the translations always miss it for some reason. And so, by whom desired and set forth does the mind flow towards its, he says subject. At whose bidding does again the chief prana proceed to its function? Page 8 in your booklet. By whom wished do men utter speech? And what effulgent one indeed directs the eye or the ear? No, I don't like that translation. So the one we have here, by whom impelled, by whom compelled, does the mind set forth to alight upon its objects? Linked together, by whom does the prana proceed as the first function of perception? By whom is the language, is this language willed with which people speak? And who is the God that joins the sight and the hearing? So just asking these questions. And so this is considered like the fundamental question. You know, here you are, and you're starting to like wake up and inquire, and what you're coming up against is the mystery of sense perception. Like, well, it's just like when, you know, certain teenagers or something, their first Friday night out, looking, and they're utterly stunned by the immediacy of the sense perception. And it's quite a mystery. I mean, it's one of the great mysteries. And instead, we ignore the mystery that's right in our face, and we go off, you know, just constructing our own biography, you know, many kind of fantasies about what we are and what the world is. And yet we've had this absolutely profound mystery right in our, right in our eyeball, right in your ear, in your nose or something, the pores of the skin. And so this is considered the fundamental mystery, you know, because when you see somebody dies, the eyeball is still there, but it's not looking. The prana seems to be gone, the breath is gone, and so it appears as if mental function. So it's like, what's going on here? And so then, of course, the answer comes. And this is both in my opinion, the answer is overly simple, but it's also interesting the way it's presented. And so he says, it is the ear, that which is the ear of the ear, the mind of the mind, the language behind the language, the eye of the eye. It is also the prana behind the prana. That's the answer. Okay. And so initially, you know, a typical Vedantist or someone, you're just describing the soul, you know, it's like, and then it says, but the last part is, freed completely from these, the wise become immortal when they depart from this world. And so, actually, here's my interpretation. Okay, so, because a lot of these old Upanishadic philosophers, you know, were very clever, and they dealt a lot with language theory in and of itself. And so, when you would say the eye of the eye, okay, what's implied, you know, to like the average person on the street, is basically inside your eye. You can't help but imagine there's a teeny little eye that's looking out of your eye. You ever have that in there? Like there's a teeny person looking out of the window, driving a giant yantar. Okay. Anyway, and hearing through your ear. So what's this mystery of hearing? It's like, what is it? What's going on? The rational mind wants to know. So it answers it just by saying, oh, there's an ear in your ear. Which is like, oh, and for most people they go, oh, that explains it totally, no problem. And there's a breath, you know, who's breathing? And so it's the breath of the breath that's really breathing. And then the mystery of language, which is the whole function of mind in these ancient, it's believed that all thought and all experience, all creation is basically linguistic in structure, meaning it's information systems. It's not necessarily spoken language, but it's information where one thing stands for something else. And doing that, you can build hierarchies of knowledge through information. And that's what creation is essentially language. So they say that Vak, or language, creative principle, is the creative shakti that is the whole universe. Similar to the idea of logos in the West. So what is it, you know, what's the language that makes the language work? And so someone who's played with this, what obviously has happened is someone has taken, the eye of the eye is equally. And if you were a two-year-old, you would then ask the question, by whom compelled does the mind set forth the light upon itself? Link together, okay. Then you would say, that which is the, so what is it that sees through the eye of the eye? What is it that hears through the ear of the ear? And what breath is breathing the breath? Mind the language of the language, and it goes on and on and on. So you just take the same mystery to another level, and it's the same mystery. Okay, so by the eye of my eye is now the ultimate explanation. I thought I'd arrive at, you know, a typical soul, but there's a little eternal eyeball that keeps changing eyeballs. But then when I ask the question, who's looking out of the eye of the eye? And then the little two-year-old asks, well, who's looking out of the eye of the eye of the eye? And then you, being a responsible adult, you say, well, it's the eye of the eye of the eye of the eye that's looking out of the eye. And you go, oh, okay. And same thing with the ear. There's the ear of the ear of the ear. And so all this is trying to explain what we call consciousness, or just this awareness, which is like, in and of itself, this absolute stunning mystery that you're currently experiencing. But somehow the structure of mind doesn't want to experience that state of almost shocked unknowing, which is the immediate mystery of life. So it keeps this causal, it looks for cause, and it always like places it outside again. And one of my favorite stories that some of you have heard before is the turtle story, which is part of the cover here.
Mm-hmm.
And the famous question where the student asks the teacher, what is it that's holding up this whole universe? Mm-hmm. And Because, you know, particularly if you study astronomy, you often go through periods of total nausea and fear when you discover, one, we're all in a big round ball that's just spinning and nothing's holding it up. And it's flying at a really fast speed around the sun, which is another big round ball, which is also floating in the middle of no place, which is gradually orbiting, very gradually, the center of our galaxy, which is in the middle of no place, and that galaxy. And it's like, if you think about it, you turn your stomach. It's like, I just want to like have some frame of reference that I can sit down on. You know, where is my pelvic floor? And so the answer, the common answer in India is, well, don't worry. The entire universe is supported by a giant turtle. And this is before modern astronomy. And turtles are very trustworthy, nice creatures. If you've ever had a pet turtle, you know, they're not real fast, but they're really stable and they're kind of grounded. So it's believed that the turtle is the support of the universe. The giant. And there are many different stories about, you know, one of the avatars of Vishnu is a giant tortoise who saves the earth by diving in the ocean of destruction and pulling the earth back up. And so then, of course, there's always someone, a two-year-old, in the audience, and they have to say, and this usually is after months and months of everyone being content with the turtle. Someone raises their hand and they say, "Oh, Babaji, oh Swamiji, what's holding up the turtle?" And there's a huge resistance to not knowing in the ego structure of mind. And so the teacher, the sage, quickly says, "Well, there's another turtle under that turtle, holding up the turtle." And then everybody goes, "Phew." Because you just can't imagine a turtle floating in the Akash, you know, with nothing, no causality. Okay. And so then everyone is content except for the two-year-old. Who's holding up the turtle? It's holding up the turtle. It's holding up the turtle. And it's hard because you lose track of the numbers of turtles. Okay. But the questioning goes on and on and on, as it does with a two-year-old. And if a two-year-old is stubborn, you can be thousands of turtles down the causal chain.
It's infinite.
And still, if I go, "What's holding up that turtle?" I mean, "Well, there must be another turtle." Okay, there's another turtle under it. Yeah. It drives you crazy. It's an infinite regress that's happens, you know, when you're looking for an absolute frame of reference, or causality, or an absolute self. You know, like we say there's self in the Vedanta, and of course in Buddhism is the basic thing is anatman, there is no self, and this is, but when we say self, what do we mean? And we start to look at it as something that's separate and solid and knowable, and that is exactly what they don't mean. It's not itself in any sense of the word self that we can come up with, like individual me sitting over here looking out. But they merely mean, in a sense, just pure awareness or pure consciousness or pure joy or pure openness, pure emptiness. And so what happens is you start to see in the process of inquiring, you know, by asking either who am I, was another, you know, Ramana Maharshi thing.
Yeah.
That was his thing, you know, who are you? Coming up in the Keno Upanishad, in the third chapter, each of the gods rush up to this mysterious little yaksha that appears, and the yaksha, who's small and cute, it's just amazing. The yaksha asks them, as they rush up and they look like cops, you know, because they're gods. They probably have multiple arms and, you know, fantastic crowns and maybe fancy weapons. And, you know, they're very impressive. And they rush up to you saying, "Who are you?" But as they rushed up to this unknown little creature, the little creature says to them, "Who are you?" And they say, just like Ramana Maharshi would, "Who are you?" And you say, "Well, I'm Richard, you know, I live in Colorado." And then they just look at it and they go, "No, who are you?" And you have to, each time you have to take what you thought was you and you trash that definition, and then you come up with another one, and then the question comes again, "Who are you?" And you have to trash that definition. And pretty soon you get just stacks and stacks of useless definitions. Anything you come up with, it's why, who. And so what is sense then is this infinite regress of how mind works, looking for self or looking for what's, you know, you're looking for either the self of some particular thing, you know, some kind of absolute framework, truly know it. If you really know it, then the constructed you, the ego, is happy and secure and maybe even immortal. You can find this. But the bottom is falling out constantly. And so, you get this, it's almost in the pit of your stomach. It's a visceral sense that, whoops, I'm falling into a black hole. Or, you know, maybe that's not even the right phrase. It's like infinite regress, you know. I don't know if there should be red flags. I think there should be maybe green flags for good news. This is fantastic news. You hit another infinite regress. And this is what the wise, knowing this, the actual term is they let go completely. So when you start to feel, oh, you're holding a situation, and you start to see the situation as actually having no absolute separateness to it, mm-hmm. Same as the word shunyata, it's emptiness. It's not like a decision, the letting go is just like, and the wise, the dhira, the sober, letting go, become immortal, or they're free of death, basically. And so that's what's pointed out in this first two verses.
Right?
It's kind of fun. But I always think of two-year-olds when I cough. There's a great book that we require people to read, or we request that people read, who come to our summer training, called Ka, which is the Sanskrit word for who. And Ka appears in the Rig Veda, you know, so it's appearing from this concept meaning who, what God, who is God. But it's used in a number of Vedic mantras where at the fire sacrifice, the priest is asking who is actually receiving, and they keep asking to make you let go of your conception of the being that is the sacrifice, that is you, that is things being offered to. And it's supposedly a fairly effective technique. So it's just like, and so in the non-dual Vedanta, Advaita Vedanta, which has to do with Patabi Joyce's lineage. He's in the lineage of Shankaracharya and Gaudapada, which is Advaita Vedanta. They say that the basic technique of practice is vichara, which is basically to inquire, you know, almost like a two-year-old.
Analysis.
So it's analysis, and then it continues on. So it has the two levels. One is vitarka, which is logical analysis. Mm-hmm. And that's like, you know, the jhana states, or that first level of samadhi, vitarka. You have samadhi accompanied by vitarka, which is a dialectic of propositions, and logical propositions. Mm-hmm. It is, it isn't. It is, it isn't. No, it is and isn't. No, it's not. And you go through all of these, and they actually help you focus the mind on something. It's just like, and what you're focusing your mind on, like when you concentrate in yoga, that's a really interesting question. Like, Mary and I were working on a book the standing posture, balancing postures. Mm-hmm. And we're trying to figure out what to say to people, like, you got to really focus to balance. So we're trying to, what are you focusing on? And so we'd stand there, like, on one leg or something. And you were very attentive. You would fall over if you weren't attentive. But we couldn't really figure out what it is. And different things would come up, you know, like, whoa, and you'd compensate almost automatically. But we couldn't figure out what it is you're actually paying attention to. Uh-huh. But you were focused. And so that was a form of that inquiry. So it's like a, it's a way of focusing on what cannot be actually perceived. But it takes what you are perceiving and doesn't reject it, but it looks at it so deeply that it's... Mm-hmm. And then a nice thing in this particular posture, they say, you can't explain this. So your explanation is just part of the that which is about to be sloughed off. But I want you to try this, when you go back to your room or your tent tonight. Anybody staying in these tents? They look nice.
I don't know if they have right stuff.
Oh, that's going to be nice in the right weather. But just stand there, you know, in vrikshasana. And if you're orthodox Ashtanga practitioner, you don't do vrikshasana. You have to stand in Ardhavada Padmasana. Yeah, Ardhavada Padmasana. Standing in the first position where you're reaching and holding, but you just stand there and do like that. And steady your gaze. Uh-huh. And then write an essay on what it is you were focusing on as you were balancing. And is something, you know, it's kind of like you get close. Oh, I'm focusing on the middle path. Okay, what do you mean? And no, I was focusing on an imaginary tube, but that was only for 2 seconds. And then I came up with some other similar but slightly different image, and I had a wide, you know. And so the actual content of the mind, although you were definitely had a focus, and a necessary focus, the actual, you could never say what it was you actually focused on. Mm-hmm. Likewise, you cannot say who you are. And you get it.
In the Buddhist thing, that's why they put vipassana, which means like the critical and analytic type of concentration, as more important to establish before the shamatha, yeah, the one-pointed thing, because then you, by that means that you pick the focus point before you actually cultivate the focus. Mm-hmm. If you just say focus without having the idea of what it is you're trying to focus on, then the mind will naturally just kind of wander around. Won't know what's focused. If it becomes stable, it just goes kind of unconscious or something. You know what I mean? Because it can't find anything. So it's more important to critically decide what you want to focus on before you focus. Yeah. So people who teach meditation as just emptying the mind, then are really dulling the person's chance of having some kind of insight. There's no inquiry.
Yeah. Yeah. They call that tamasic samadhi.
What? Tamasic samadhi. Tamasic samadhi, yeah. Right. Exactly.
In Boulder, where there's a lot of that.
Probably.
Yeah, particularly in the summer. There was a Grateful Dead concert there on this last week.
It was like now?
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah. All the old dead.
There's a few undead,
resurrected.
Yeah.
Zombies, they're called now. They're flooding into Boulder.
I see it. Vicky was there for your horn. Bobby Weir were there.
Bobby Weir was there, yeah.
Yeah. Oh. They're still staggering along, that's good.
I guess that's like the last one. It's like the big hurrah.
Another big room.
But isn't it like the last one? It's like a
oh, I don't know.
No, they said that last time.
That was last year.
Well, my friends are there, Richard, so take it easy on us.
Oh.
But they're not zombies. Yeah. Hey, yes.
Simon's getting close to being done.
The letting go thing, I think, is very interesting. Yeah. You know, Mucha, when they let go, the wise let go, then they become immortal as leaving this world. Going beyond the world. That reminds me of the Theravada Buddhism very, very much.
It's also like Yoga Sutra.
The what?
Yoga Sutra.
Yeah.
The beginning.
Yeah,
where you get that through Abhyasa and Vairagya.
Mm-hmm.
Then you get the Nirodha Uchitta. So the Abhyasa is the concentration.
Mm-hmm.
You know, on the chosen, whatever it is.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and hopefully there's some. And so the Abhyasa is the actual practice.
Right.
And it involves what we call vinyasa in
mm-hmm.
the contemporary yoga world, in which you want to focus the mind on something, say your heart.
Mm-hmm.
But it's just not going there because you got all these distractions. So you have to work your way. And the heart is like a mandala. And so you work your way around the outer edges of the mandala
mm-hmm.
Through placing your attention in this petal, which is your relationship with, you know, your favorite politician or something. Things that drive you nuts. We're talking, you know, entities that you put outside of your heart.
Mm-hmm.
You're not going to focus your mind in your heart if you've got other beings that don't live there. So. And so you've got to do this dialectical process of vinyasa, specific placement here, and then you balance it over here, this pedal, you go around and around and around until finally it's balanced, and then you do a sannyasa. You just
mm-hmm.
offer it. It's like, and that offering is not like something you have, it's just natural, and the offering is the complete release of it. And at that point, the whole, you see the entire universe, everything is there in that pattern of focus. So the seed of the samadhi is then released, and in that vairagyam, that's where the insight comes. And so the vipassana, or the insight, is really inseparable, because you see it. If you see it as empty, you're not going to nothing to hold on to. It's like you're
mm-hmm.
playing with something and you discover it's made of sand. And
mm-hmm.
like that. And so, you know, the chapter goes, sight does not go there, neither does thinking or speech. We don't know, we cannot perceive how one could teach this. It's very hard, like with mulabandha, we were talking earlier today, that if you do mulabandha,
mm-hmm.
Which is, and mulabandha talk is cheap talk, particularly in the Ashtanga community. Every Starbucks you go to around the world, there's somebody with a sticky mat talking about their mulabandha. Yeah, you know, I just did the bandha. Have you noticed that? But there we're talking this morning about a verse from Shankaracharya that mulabandha actually is chittabandha. And so
chittabandha?
Yeah, is mulabandha.
Mm-hmm.
Because if the process of mulabandha starts working, then the chitta basically is nirodha. So it's not what you think it is. So any image you make of mulabandha, which you need images, because you got to start with, because
mm-hmm.
I imagine my pelvic floor, and then you imagine like, there are traditional things where you imagine Kamadev sitting on a peacock in the middle of your pelvic
mm-hmm.
floor, and he has a beautiful flame on the top of his head, and you have the yin and the yang.
Mm-hmm.
And so it's, and then they say, well, that flame, which is just pure citta, that's the Moolabandha. But it's always, it's the same process. It's, mm-hmm. As soon as you start to feel it, and the idea is you're really feeling these sensation patterns, this flow in the bodies and chakras, as soon as you feel it, it's like you're stunned. And you can't explain what's going on. And so it turns out in that which is the most important thing talk about, the most interesting thing, mm-hmm. can't be talked about.
Well, it can't be captured in talk.
No, it can't.
Therefore, people talk a lot about it.
You can't say it.
As the Zen master said, he said that the Buddha never said a single word from the time of his enlightenment until he passed away. Such a garrulous non-speaking filled the Dragon King's cave with scriptures.
One of the, is that Suzuki or Sasaki?
Right.
Said the most important thing is to find out what the most important thing is.
That sounds like Suzuki.
That's more like Suzuki.
The California one. Yeah. He was always good at that thing. He's the one who said, everything is perfect. But there's always a little room for improvement. That's great. What does he mean by beyond the unknown? This translation makes 3 and 4 into 2 verses, but it's really 1 verse in here, right?
My iPad shut down, but sight does not reach there. No, I think they're just combined here.
Yeah,
it's not good there.
This is still in number 3 here. Avidita tapi. Mm-hmm. You know, like, also from what is not known.
Yeah.
So how do you go beyond what is not known? You go beyond what is known and also what is not known.
Yeah, it is harder than what's known and it is further than the unknown. So I think what they do here in this translation, it says, different it is from all that are known. Is beyond the unknown as well. Mm-hmm. Thus we have heard from the ancient seers who have explained this to us. And so basically with unknown, what happens to me is somebody says, oh, that's unknown. I still come up with a concept mm-hmm. of the unknown.
Okay.
And it's definitely not my concept of the unknown, which is, you know, I choose a concept of convenience. Or if somebody says Brahman, mm-hmm. you know, I think, oh, Brahman is like this big ocean of light. You know, it's just too cool. And definitely, that's just some idea that I have. And it isn't that idea. You know, it's that idea is composed of Brahman, and it's mm-hmm. structured, but that isn't. Or with shunyata, emptiness, mm-hmm. you know, I've got all kinds of pictures that come up in my mind of like, big open skies, sunny
yep.
days,
yes.
You know, cosmic things, but they're all empty. Those mm-hmm. ideas of emptiness
sure.
are definitely not emptiness. Mm-hmm. Although they are empty, but they're not emptiness. And so they're just playing with that paradox
thing. What I think is a very central thing that I'm very puzzled about or interested in. Is that you know, the Buddha taught the 4 formless realms, as they say, although I think it should be immaterial realms, or the realms of pure mind, as okay. infinite space, infinite consciousness, absolute nothingness. These are ayatanas, or media. They don't really say space or place, because there's no mass. You know, it's all mental, there's no body in it, supposedly, although there is subtle body, but basically no body. And then the 4th one is called beyond consciousness and unconsciousness. And I was reading a book the other day about a guy in Colorado, actually, I forgot his name, one meditation teacher. And he was saying, well, of course, you can train yourself to be conscious of being unconscious. He said, and the fourth state, right, for the Nirvikalpa Samadhi is being both neither conscious nor unconscious, because it's not waking and it's not sleep. So you're both conscious and unconscious at the same time, which is neither conscious nor unconscious. Is that, how is that done? That's a very strange question. That's very strange.
It is weird.
Because in a way, it fits very well with the subtle mind and super subtle mind of tantric Abhidharma, what you could say called, where the subtle mind is the moonlight space, sunlit space, and dark space, you know, pitch dark space. So that's the subtle mind of those three spaces in which there are 80 instincts that cause one to shoot past the super subtle mind, which is the clear light. So to me, that those four states of the thing are upside down. You know, those are the four formless realms, actually. Buddha taught the same thing in terms of the formless realms. And the Hindus have it, the Hindu yogis have it as also the Turiya. Swapna, Jagat, Swapna, and there's dream and sleep, right? That's where I'm saying, whatever it is. So in other words, you go through being conscious, being in a vast space, of a vast space, then being your consciousness ever in a vast space, then being unconscious, and then in some state that is both conscious and unconscious.
Yeah.
So what is that state? How can that be?
Right. Well, I think they're saying you can't imagine. Whatever you imagine it is,
yes.
That is
okay.
It. But, so you've got to check it out.
Yeah.
The mind will generate some kind of subtle realm. And then, at some point, you want to say, well, that subtle realm is it. And then,
yes, that's the big danger of Buddha taught us.
Yeah, and so he set this up to make sure that even that.
He distinguished those four states from Nirvana. He said Nirvana is not any of those four states.
Yeah, you see through the even that. But that which you would normally, if you experience that, just on Friday night or something, you would think, I got it. That is like the ultimate experience, And actually, then you're still on a subtle level, mistaking the content of what the experience was with experiencing, and that mistake, avidya, happens to even the most successful yogis and gods, particularly the gods, they're always falling.
Well, that's the danger, that one becomes a deity of those realms. There's lots of them. Apparently, there's like a very high population of escapist yogis who settle down in one of those states, and then they actually become deities of those states. And they stay there a long time, but then they're back, so it actually was a trap. They delayed their number two non-duality experience. So it's like the clear light of the void, which is associated with the Dharmakaya, associated with death, associated with the super subtle mind, with the Buddha mind, with non-duality, blah, blah, blah. Apparently there's a way of staying there, being stuck there. So there must be some sort of vestigial, egocentric thing that caused certain yogis to be stuck there.
Yeah.
But they can't be stuck there because it's everywhere.
If it's actually what it is,
So they can't really.
They're stuck in like some kind of not imitation, but subtle kind of flow of some kind of structure.
They can't see it as a structure.
Yeah, they can't see it as a structure, but they're making the classical mistake.
Yeah.
Same mistake as that any organism makes, where they mistake content.
Right.
Sort of thing.
It's sort of an inverse hell, actually.
yeah.
Of ultimate alienation, but thinking of that as the highest event.
Yeah.
And then, but then how does it happen that when both conscious and unconscious? No, you can. I guess you can. You can't. Of course, right. You can't explain it. So that's lucky. So don't have to worry. But
in other words, they're saying, don't get too puffed up because you have all these. Don't get too puffed up with all these fantastic experiences, because then you forget what's important.
Oh yeah. Well, that's a terrible thing. Someone who has an experience of disappearing, and then thinks, and then comes back from it. Of course, because it's. Since it's a constructed state, it cannot be absolute. So then they return from that, but then they think it was, when they were there, they were the absolute. So then they become absolutely egotistical, using that term in a impressionistic way. And that's a terrible fate. You know, the Zen, they call that being trapped in the demon ghost cave of emptiness, of thinking a real emptiness that I realize. They do. Because the only way to realize emptiness is to disappear in it, so you don't have the experience of it. But still, then again they say that to be a Buddha, you have to be conscious at every plane simultaneously. Like even in Pali, in the Pali literature, which is dualistic Buddhism, therefore, that leaving it, catering to an element of escapism in the sensitive person. In the Pali literature, when in the Parinibbana Sutta, you know, they don't like those consonant clusters, so Parinibbana Sutta. In that sutta, when he attains Parinibbana, you know, he's lying down there, they say his mind goes up through the four dhyana realms, four immeasurable realms, and then crosses over beyond mass into the immaterial realm, and goes through those four, up to the beyond consciousness and unconsciousness. Then comes back down in his mind to the first immeasurable, the love state, you know, the immeasurable love state, right? The four dhyanas, right? The first one. Back again, there's vitarka vichara there, right? As you said. And then goes up to the boundary between the material, and immaterial, the four immeasurable material immeasurables and the immaterial. And from that boundary then enters Parinibbana, they say. So they don't say that he enters Parinibbana from the fourth state, as if it was the ninth state. He enters from where between body and mind. And then in the Mahayana, cosmologically sort of, they say that's the Brahma Akanishta, you know, Brahma's dwelling, Akanishta, where Brahma dwells. And they say that that's where all the Buddha lands are. That's the doorway into the Buddha land, that Brahma realm. Although they sort of skimpily or stingily exclude Brahma from them.
Yeah, it's his place.
Yeah, he's in a little lower part of the Akanishta, they claim. Throne room, you know, it's like under there, that's stupid. And then, you know, like Amitabha's pure land, Akshobhya's pure land, so they are there. So that's the sort of mass becomes infinite boundary, that's the speed of light place. I mean, like, idea. So that hint is right there in Parinibbana. But then later in Sri Lanka, some of the commentators, they act like Nibbana's a ninth state. They sort of don't notice that in their own sutta, or they ignore it, or they explain it away. And then they act like it's a ninth state that's even more quiet.
Yeah.
And more apart from any kind of anybody bothering you. The more isolated. That's if that was their problem. They do.
Yeah.
But still, I wanna be conscious and unconscious at the same time. You know? Explain how.
A lot of us just are like that.
What?
A lot of us are like that.
Oh, really?
Semi-conscious.
Well, then I'm missing out. Terrible. But you know, the analogy of the mirror is so good. And that's what I'm playing with. Though.
Yeah.
Because when we look at a reflection in a mirror, we don't have to think twice about the fact that it's a reflection in the mirror. And do we call that, we intuit it's just a reflection in the mirror? And so then we can pay total attention to the detail of the reflection. And we don't worry, we don't get confused that it's not a mirror image, because we, so in a sense, we are knowing simultaneously that it's just a mirror reflection. So we meant that the brain and the mind will correct any kind of distortion from the mirror without thinking, right? But that seems to be a cop-out, because then we say we're knowing it's just a mirror without having to think that we know. And we're sort of thinking about the details of the relational stuff in the mirror. But that's, they say that's the best. No analogy will work, of course, but they say that's the best one. Huh?
Yeah.
But I'm not saying, it doesn't satisfy me quite.
Yeah,
it helps, but doesn't satisfy.
Yeah. And the mirror itself is awareness. But it has no form or content.
Yeah.
It merely reflects other patterns. You know, it's
yeah.
pattern reflected
yeah.
in mind.
Yeah. So, but it's a really key thing, because
yeah,
how do you distinguish, you know, like non-duality? The emptiness non-duality. Where because emptiness is empty, then emptiness is all of the presence in the relational thing. And then supposedly, if you know simultaneously in dealing with all the relational things that they are emptiness, you simultaneously never lose sight of that fact, which would be, you'd have to be a Buddha supposedly, then you're blissfully engaged with all the relative things, even the ones that seem painful and horrible and so on. So it's the difference between being resigned to there's only this relative world like a materialist, and being blissfully engaged in relativity that you know is emptiness. But in what way of knowing? I can't figure it out. Because I don't know, of course, but... So that's, I'm looking for the answer to that here in the Kinna.
Well, there's a couple of verbs. Verse 4 of the second chapter.
Verse 4 of the second chapter. Mm-hmm. That's going to be the answer.
Well,
ta-da.
It's a nice verse. I don't know if it'll answer.
Okay, you have a state of cognition. Yes,
yes.
That's right. So
and
you're
so
in
the
other state, but you always are knowing
yeah.
that.
In other words, you're... It's hard to have two different things. Let's see. It sounds good.
I think
okay.
this translation... Who did this translation?
This one? This one. But I fixed it up, you know.
I know, but...
We did this, and then I said, I don't like that. And so, prati, in other words, what the Sanskrit word is, unfortunately, this other text is so old, I can't even read the font one, that you're waking up, oh, here
yeah.
it is, pratibodha viditam.
Pratibodha
yeah,
viditam.
So, pratibodha.
Pratibodha viditam.
Yeah.
So it's
realized. Yeah.
Oh, go
it's
ahead.
Realized as from every state, no matter what the state is.
Yes.
You're waking up out of that state.
Uh huh.
So it doesn't mean whether it's the highest state. You're waking up out of the highest state. So it's like this image of continuous awakening, in which no context is allowed to form or become absolute. And so this also allows, you know, the meditation practice where whatever is actually happening, that's what you meditate on. And then you wake up, and the process is that of awakening.
Uh-huh.
For awakening. Pratibodha is you wake up.
Right. So this amritam stands for Brahma. Right? Amritam.
Yeah.
So matam amritatvam.
Mm-hmm.
So immortality. The mind is immortality. Knowing, awakening. Pratibodha vintam matam amritatvam ivindate. And it finds, indeed, it is found. Right?
Mm-hmm.
That immortality is found. Matam. Matam means the mind, right? Matam, yeah, understood, the mind. So that's in the same area. So cool.
Mm-hmm.
Very cool. Atmanam indate viryam vidyaya indate amritam. So by the self is found heroism, courage, viryam.
Mm-hmm.
He translates it as power. But viryam means, also means courage.
I like
effort, power.
Yeah, he translated it as strength, but I like courage.
Courage is good.
Because I always think of, because you have to have courage in the experience of not knowing, which is consistent in yoga. So I say you have to have virya, you have shraddha and virya. So shraddha is the ability to be there, but you're not knowing, you're just trusting.
Uh-huh, okay.
But you don't have like
any... So the self is not knowing but trusting? It's like making a difference between Atmana and Vidyaya and wisdom, right? Mm-hmm. Knowledge. So the self is a not-knowing side, and Vidyaya is the knowing side, meaning that they are Uttam. Mm-hmm. So the knowing side finds immortality, and the self side finds courage. Mm-hmm. That's very non-dual.
It's non-dual.
I like that. That's very Buddhist.
Oh, yeah.
Very enlightened. What are they saying? This is not Buddhist. No, very Buddhist.
I think there are a lot of Prachapavits, secret Buddhas.
But Sanabharas, like Shankara?
Yeah, like Shankara. They were sent as spies.
And then why did Ramanuja, what did Pratapito, it's a piece of Shankaracharya person, what did he say about Ramanuja kicking out Shankaracharya? Yeah. Saying he was a Prachanabhava.
Oh, he would have been kicked out with them. Yeah.
Oh, he would have agreed.
Yeah, those are the critics. Out. Those are the critics of Shankaracharya, who don't like non-dualism.
Yeah, they didn't like Nirguna Brahman. They
like their own particular.
No, thing. They liked non-dualism, but they only called it qualified non-dualism.
Right.
And then finally, they achieved the final highest achievement: dualistic non-dualism. So Patanjali wouldn't hang out with them.
No,
that's. That's very good. So the Atma, that's very interesting. They have the Atma and it's the unknowing. We'll have to learn Sanskrit.
Sorry.
That wouldn't hurt you. Not that bad.
No, it's actually fun. I mean, I'm kind of stuck in
then you can get to heaven.
Second grade. Yeah. And if you don't, you can't get it. Yeah. I wondered, when you die. And
you know Kavidasa's story? There's another way you can learn it, an easier way. You know that story?
No.
Kavidasa was a commoner, right? And there was this Siddha, Brahmin Siddha, who was very pissed off at one queen, beautiful queen. She was a great Sanskritist and very kind of snobby. So then, and she was snobby about that Brahmin Siddha, and then he was annoyed with her, so he wanted to trick her. So then he took this Kalidasa guy and said, "Now you want to marry this queen, and I'm going to do this whole thing." And he took the guy to the queen, and then he ventriloquized all kind of brilliant Sanskrit in this shepherd, cowherd. And then she got all turned on to him, So then they got married. But they didn't meet properly, but they got married. And then when after marriage, she discovered that he was an illiterate cowherd and couldn't know any Sanskrit, and she'd been tricked by the old Brahmin who she had been snobby with. So she threw him out. But he by this time was fully smitten. So he went to a shrine of Kali. And he said, "I love my queen, my wife. Please give me the gift of the knowledge of Sanskrit." And then he suddenly became the greatest Sanskrit poet. And Goethe said he was the greatest poet who ever lived in any language.
Yeah.
I don't know how much Sanskrit Goethe knew, but he thought that. So then you just pray to Kali or someone really earnestly, and then you just have Sanskrit like bang. Like in the Matrix, right?
Yeah.
The guy just plugs in a thing, you're back in the submarine, and then you can fly the helicopter. Remember? I know. Why can't we do that?
The Matrix had it.
I'm sorry. That's really great. Okay, I'm sorry. Like, what verse are we on?
Oh, well, we're just finishing. The second chapter. So one awakens to know through every state of cognition. So this is super important for practitioners because we become idealistic in our practice. And we think, well, I'm having a terrible meditation. You know, you're sitting there, but it is, you know, your mind is all over the place and it's miserable. And then you do your yoga practice and your posture's miserable. And all you're worried about is how you look to everybody else, even though they're all ignoring you and they don't care. And you are not actually observing your actual state of mind as the object of meditation, but you're just being idealistic and then torturing yourself with, you know, like, I will only meditate upon God. You know, I've actually met a lot of people who say, when I meditate, I only meditate on God.
Oh, and God?
Yeah, so they don't want to watch their breath or, you know, their perineum.
Oh, really?
You know. Or the fly on the wall. You know, they just don't want to look at it as it is. They want to be, oh, I'm only meditating on God. And very difficult. And the Gita, this whole question, Arjuna asks, which is it better to meditate on that which is manifest or unmanifest? And Krishna, of course, gives the answer. He says, well, it's very difficult to meditate on what is not arising, the avyakta. Very difficult. And this is after you've been teaching about, you know, the light of the sun and the moon,
right.
The beauty of all these forms, and, you know, basically immanence. You know, basically observing what's actually arising as being Krishna rather than manifest. But we all fall into that. Well, on occasion, where you're trying to meditate on the unmanifest, which is really, really hard, rather than meditating on what's arising in your mind, which is the citta vritti.
The only way to unmanifest is a negation.
Yeah.
So the only way to discover the unmanifest is to try to find the manifest and fail.
Yeah, to actually look at the manifest and look closely. With samadhi, and you say there's nothing there.
That's the thing, coping then with the failure.
So a lot of yogis, they think, well, citta vrittis are bad.
It's bad?
Because you're going to do nirodha on them, you're going to get rid of them.
Right.
And so they're like flies or insects that are tormenting you.
Right.
And so they're struggling with their citta vrittis, you know, swatting at them and scratching at them. And again, it was Shankaracharya, or one of the Shankaracharyas.
Right.
It says that what you do is you take the vritti and you simply make it still by looking at it. You know, then you start to see what it is. Then they say you see that the citta vritti itself, the pattern of the mind, the pattern of the prana actually, is Brahma, and then upon seeing that, you let it go. The same pattern.
So, okay.
And I think, you know, for me, that was a great one day I kind of got that. And I think for a lot of meditators, in fact, it's like, what a relief. I've got plenty to meditate on. It's coming up right now.
I think it's time to sleep. I think now the challenge is to be unconscious, sleeping consciousness. But remember, please do the Menla yoga. Remember, don't be conscious. Be unconscious so you can rest. But then visualize that your unconsciousness will actually be lying in clear light. And the only reason you don't see it is because your seeing mechanisms are themselves clear up. And it's all transparency. Then you'll be very energized at 5 a.m. for your Mysore style. And also it said, for example, in Tantra, when you do visualizations of things, they always say, you know, shunyata bhavatu, may all become, or bhavantu, may all, sarve shunyata bhavantu. They all become emptiness. But they say, and then out of the emptiness arises the mandala or whatever it is, you know, bit by bit, you know, they have like different scripts for that, that you practice. But they say, you know, you took me here, so I finally found some commentary, I think I said, and I thought, oh, that's really good. And he said, they said, don't think of a dark, nothing space when you say, let all become empty. Don't think of a dark space where everything disappeared into. I didn't really say what to think of, but of course you think that you must, when you say, let all become empty, you must think of clear light. Like everything becomes like made of diamond or made of glass or somehow transparent, even in its delicacy. And therefore, infinitely transformable into whatever is needed, you know, to make everybody happy, something like that. So it's best never to think about nothing as if it were something. Okay.